So where do I plug this thing in here? Right there?
Plug it in right there.
And how do I get out of this?
X out of it, I think.
Right there, okay.
Please stand by.
No, continue without scanning. Open the folder.
That one?
Yeah. Okay, I think I got it.
Yes, I got it?
I think I got it, yeah.
Make it work, make it work.
Yeah, right. All right, let's see.
Oh, you to my hand.
All right.
You to my hand.
All right, everybody can see that? You guys in the way back, you have binoculars back there? You might want to move up here. If you paid money to be in this event, you probably want to see what we're talking about. I got a lot of pictures with some really interesting information.
Okay, I'm Rick Austin. I'm also known as the Survivalist Gardener. Tell you a little bit about my journey. I started when I was in high school. I worked for my dad. I was a plumber's son. Being a bottom man on the totem pole, I always got the choice jobs. One day when I was standing knee deep in human excrement, digging a ditch to a septic tank, I said, you know, I think I'm going to do something else with my life. Maybe I'll go to college and, do something different. So I did, and a lot of people would say I did pretty well for myself. I ran advertising agencies, publications, ended up being a television producer at Universal Studios. And when we finally got to the point where we said, you know, things are just getting really bad out there. Let's create our own little homestead and move to Western North Carolina. I started an orchard, vineyard, and berry farm to go along with that, so we'd be self-sustaining. And now I'm a full-fledged farmer. We've got 40-plus animals, everything from ducks and chickens and goats and rabbits to dogs. And you know where I spend most of my time doing every day? Shoveling poop. Along the way, I used to be a traditional apple farmer. I had apple orchards, and they were just like every other apple orchard out there. You know, rows and rows of trees in all directions with the leaves touching each other, no space in between, with just grass growing in between. And little did I know that the grass sucked up the same nutrients that the apple trees needed. And like every other apple farmer out there, excuse me, I sprayed pesticide and used fertilizer, and I sprayed pesticide every 10 days and after every rain, and I still had scabby, wormy apples just like every other apple farmer. So I knew there had to be a better way. I've also been a, quote, survivalist and prepper long before they coined the terms. I grew up in New Hampshire. I lived through New Hampshire winters. Where you can lose power for a week at a time because of a snow or an ice storm, and you learn how to cook with wood, you learn how to heat with wood, you learn how to store your food outside in the snow. I also spent the latter part of my life before I moved up here in Florida and in the hurricane and lightning capital of the world, where again you can lose power for 7 days at a time. The only difference is it's 90 plus degrees and 90% humidity, and if you put your stuff outside, it might be a little cooler than inside the house. But you've got a whole different storage problem for food. So, I developed this concept called nature culture as a result of a lot of experimenting, trial and error, 30 years of doing different stuff, and in all kinds of different environments, with orchards, berries, and grapes, vineyards. You know, I've done something that a lot of people are paying attention to. I now have agriculture experts visit my farm. I speak at conferences like this one. I'm on the board of the Cooperative Extension here in the state. I've got a website, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, all this stuff I never thought I'd have. And people asked me to write a book, so I did. It's called The Secret Garden of Survival, How to Grow a Camouflage Food Forest. It was released last Christmas. It is now the number one best-selling book in garden design. Not prepper garden design, not survival garden, but the number one best-selling book in garden design. So a lot of people are interested in it. They say when you make enough mistakes, you become an expert. So I ended up being on Doomsday Castle. I ended up planting the garden for those guys there, their survival garden. I'm working on a project right now with Survivor Jane, who's up in the back for Doomsday Preppers. Each week, now that the show's out, we do a build that is a budget build based on what is going on in those different episodes. Last week, they had their opening show, and a guy had an underwater cache. He had these stainless steel caches that he had to basically weld together and weld closed and put them under the ocean. You had to have scuba gear to get it. And we said, you know what? You can do the same thing with a plastic PVC pipe and you know, a screw-on fitting. So we show how to do that kind of stuff too, including, you know, what kind of pipe you need and how to make it all happen. So I've been in Mother Earth News twice. I've also got a radio show called Secrets of a Survivalist, which is on the Preparedness Radio Network. So how are you prepared? How many here have a bug out bag? Show of hands. Hey, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. How many have a place to shelter? How many have preps for home defense? Oh, this is my kind of crowd. How many have preparations for your pets? Okay. Well, in my family, all of us are preppers and all of us have tin hats. How many have food and water storage for 1 month? Okay. For 6 months? For a year? We drop off quite a bit there. How many have considered homestead food producing animals like chickens, ducks, goats, rabbits? I'm going to talk a little bit about why I like these. The ducks up there on the left-hand corner are Peking ducks. They are white ducks, about the size of geese almost. They're huge ducks. They're so heavy they can't fly. And they are an essential addition to my garden. They provide me with protein, and they lay eggs. They produce babies. That's for meat. And while they're out there, they go out in my garden. And unlike chickens, they don't scratch, so they don't dig stuff up, and they eat the bugs, the slugs, the snails, and all kinds of other stuff that I don't want to have on my food and my fruit. I've got dairy goats. We chose Nigerian dwarfs. They're small, almost dog-like size. They produce a tremendous amount of milk for very little input. So they don't take a lot of feed, they don't take a lot of space. But they produce an awful lot of milk. And in fact, we are always struggling trying to figure out what we can do with the milk that we've got, because we've got milk. I use it in coffee. We use it, you know, for cream, butter, and we make ice cream all the time. So as a prepper in a grid down situation, we're still going to have ice cream. We're still going to have cheese. We just had a Halloween party last night, and my wife made little cheese balls and decorated them so they look like eyeballs. They were really neat. They're really neat. I like rabbits as a source of protein. They also don't take up much space. These are the rabbits that we have are Champagne d'Argent, which basically just means silver rabbit in French. They are prolific breeders, and they produce an awful lot of meat in a short period of time. So which came first, the egg or the rabbit? With three does, three female rabbits, and one buck, you can produce 90 kits a year. That's 90 meals for myself and my wife with just three females and one male rabbit. Okay, how are you prepared? How will you feed all your animals after the poo hits the fan and you can't run to the feed store? That's one way to do it, but it kind of screw up your garden, I think. So, let's say you survive the end of the world as we know it, and let's say you survive for a year. What are you and your livestock going to eat when the food stores run out? How will you replenish a year's food storage and then feed yourself each and every year after that? And how do you keep others from stealing it? Almost more important. Who thinks this is a garden? Show of hands. It's pretty obviously a garden. There's rows and rows of food there, looks like. And that house back there looks like it's a barn, farm type thing. Who thinks this is a garden? You guys are cheaters. Well, they are both gardens. Which one would the starving hordes eat? When we have a grid down situation, you have hungry people coming from Charlotte, Asheville even, and they're looking for food. That is a bullseye target right there on the lower left-hand corner. That tells people you've got food, and even if that food is not ripe, they're going to assume that you have food stored in that house. So that makes you a target. Which one produces more food? Conventional wisdom would say that the garden on the lower left does. But it's this one. It's a perennial food forest. So imagine a garden that you plant once in your lifetime, that takes up very little space, that grows five times more food per square foot than a traditional garden, that provides food for the next 30 years, that you never have to weed, never have to use fertilizers, and never have to use pesticide ever. All disguised to look like overgrown underbrush. What it is, it's what I call nature culture, which is basically natural agriculture. You plant once and then harvest for a lifetime. You let nature do what nature does best. And in my opinion, every time man thinks he can do it better, he screws it up. You plant things together that create a symbiotic relationship. Has anybody ever read the book Carrots Love Tomatoes? Heard that book? Basically, you plant tomatoes and carrots together. They do better together than they do by themselves. Well, it's like that, but it's for an entire perennial ecosystem. You use plants to attract good bugs that'll kill the bad bugs. If you plant onions around the base of a tree, mice won't go near it in the wintertime and gird that tree. If you plant daffodils around the drip line, deer won't go near it. So if you have problems with deer stealing your apples, if you plant daffodils around it, they will stay away from it. They don't like the smell of the daffodils. Here's an example of symbiotic plantings. On the left, you've got tomato. And in the middle, you've got catnip. Now, if you plant catnip next to tomatoes, tomato hornworms won't go near it. So all those people who have problems losing their tomatoes because of tomato hornworms, if you plant it next to catnip, you won't have that problem. On the right is mustard. And that is a great plant to have in your garden. You can eat the leaves like lettuce. It's kind of got a spicy mustard flavor. You can save the seeds at the end of the year, and you can make literally the condiment mustard. It's also a nitrogen fixer. What it does is it has roots in the soil. It takes nitrogen out of the air, and it puts it back in the soil for the other plants around it. It's also a great trap plant. Any of you heard of harlequin bugs? You know why they call them harlequin bugs? Because they're always mating. That is a trap plant. They love that plant. They will go there and congregate. They have a little bar going or something there. I think it's like match.com for harlequin bugs. So the great news is you can go around on your mustard plants and you can squish two with one squish. So Attracting good bugs. This is one of my favorite herbs. It's called mountain mint. It's extremely high in camphor. You walk by that plant, it's very aromatic. It's always covered with predatory wasps, with honeybees. It's the kind of thing that you wouldn't want to make a tea out of because it's so strong, but you can save those leaves and you can use them in the winter time. And literally, if you have a cold and you can't breathe, your nose is stuffed up, if you stick one of those leaves up your nose, it clears it up just like that. It attracts, it's got little florets, these little teeny tiny flowers around it that are always in bloom. And it is covered, you can see, with predatory wasps. And what those do, they go there to get the nectar. And if you plant those in such a way around your other plants, the bad bugs have to go past them before they can get to your other plants. So these will kill the bad bugs you don't want to have in the rest of your garden. It's planting in concentric circles, not rows, because this is the way nature does things. In the center, you've got a vine layer when vines naturally grow on trees. You've got your central fruit tree for your little ecosystem. So your apple trees, pear trees, peach trees, whatever it happens to be, is in the center. And then around that, outside, you know, underneath that, you've got a shaded area, basically where the canopy of that tree is. So certain types of plants will grow well there. Dill, for example, like shades, that does well underneath that. Around that, you've got another area where you get sunlight. So that's where your berry bush, your shrub layer is. And then around that, you've got your herb layer, which are your medicinal herbs and cooking herbs. And then around that, you've got your ground cover layer. You're also planting in three dimensions. So you can actually grow five times more food per square foot because you're planting vertically as well as outside. And here's an example where we're planting in three dimensions. This is when we first planted. That tree, sort of tall tree right there, is actually a peach tree. And in front of that, we've got, I think that's oregano, catnip. Wish I had a pointer so I could show you. We've got parsley, we've got rosemary back there, and then back behind that, we've got our shrub layer. So we've got edible plants like blueberries and blackberries, and that's what they look like when we planted them. Vines naturally grow on trees. Do we have a pointer? Oh man, how does it work? Oh, wow, technology. All right, vines naturally grow on trees, so guess what? Grapes actually do better growing on trees than they do on trellises. It's really against conventional wisdom. Most people plant grapes on trellises because it just makes it easy for the farmer to go down and harvest them. But actually, they don't like it. These are two-year-old grapes on a trellis. This is muscadine grape, native to this area. And we planted grapes on trellises because I'm not a fool. You know, we tried everything. So, and we also planted them on trees. So that's a two-year-old grape on a trellis. That is a two-year-old grape on an apple tree. That produces seven times more fruit than the grapes that we have on trellises. So there's grapes, there's apples, which aren't red yet, but you can see they're both growing together and they actually do better together than they do by themselves. As it turns out, you know, grapes like mottled sun as opposed to full sun, and they have a symbiotic relationship that where they do better together. What it is, because you don't use row planting, it looks wild and overgrown, it looks camouflaged, it all blends in, there's really no definable shapes. Everything grows better together than they do in rows, and here we've got just a lot of stuff growing together. Can anybody name any of those plants? Anybody want to venture anything? The one in back is what? What's that? Okay, that's a pear. That's comfrey. Comfrey is a great plant to have. It's It's got a 30-foot taproot, so it'll reach down and grab minerals that the other plants can't reach and bring them up to the soil and make them available for the other plants that are in that little ecosystem. It's also a great plant. There's all kinds of medicinal uses you can use it. And also, you can also use it as a wound press. As I told the guys on Doomsday Castle, if you get shot, you can put that on and it'll stop the bleeding. I've got mountain mint over there as well, and another mint. Anybody see the watermelon? There it is, right there. And I asked you to look for it, and you still couldn't see it. So this is a 2-foot by 2-foot square in my garden. And I'll show you the stuff that's growing there. Okay, that's peanuts, that's beans, that is cucumber, that viney thing is actually passion fruit, that's mountain mint, that's comfrey, that's mint. I've got some clover growing over here, I've got some oats over here for my goats, and all of that stuff is growing in a 2-foot by 2-foot square. So if you're looking at, row gardens, you can tell what those plants are, but here everything's intermingled, everything's working together, and, against conventional wisdom. This is the way nature has grown things for millions of years. Pardon me? I'll get to that a little bit later. We'll save the questions for the end. I'll get through all of this stuff, and you guys can ask all the questions you want. What it's not work. I used to hate traditional gardening. I used to hate weeding. I used to hate having to go out there and plant three things and pull two of them up so that the rest, that one could live. It's not weeding. It's not work. All you do is harvest. I like to tell people that weeds are just misunderstood plants. Weeds are actually pioneer plants. So they will grow where nothing else will. They are the first ones in a succession of plants that grow in an area. So if you have barren soil, nature hates a vacuum, they're the first ones to go in. And they will grow where nothing else will. They will break up hard-packed soil, they will break up clay, they will make it easier for water and air to get in there. They end up helping the microorganisms get started. So if you've got weeds growing, it's because you've got poor soil, and it's really the first thing to go in there. Eventually they will die back, and eventually other plants will take their place once that soil is better and those microorganisms and nutrients are in there. They also flower when other plants have completely stopped blooming whatsoever. So if you've got honeybees like I do, they're flowering and they're food for the bees when nothing else is growing. I've got 7 hives, and this whole secret garden that we've got is less than 1/2 acre, and those 7 hives work in that all the time. Bees will fly as far as 5 miles to get pollen and nectar. They don't have to go that far, so they can make a lot more trips in my place. I have extracted 60 pounds of honey per hive in 7 hives. That's a lot of honey, and we use that for everything. For all of our sweetening, for preserving and everything else. So, weeds to you or feed to me. That's prickly lettuce right there. I will just go out and I will take my machete and I'll chop stuff like that down and I will throw it over the fence to the goats, and they love that stuff. And so they're making protein for me using those weeds. It's not using pesticides. 90% of the bugs in your garden are good bugs. Unfortunately, pesticide kills the good bugs too, and it usually kills them first. And if you understand nature and the nature of things, there are far fewer predators than they are prey. That's just the way things work. So if you kill those predators, suddenly you have all those bad bugs that can now multiply unchecked, and you can end up with a bigger problem than you had to start with. It's not using fertilizer because we use plants to do things that nature has done for millions of years to add, like I said, nitrogen back to the soil, for example. There's no need for watering. If you set up the infrastructure properly in the first place, you can build on the side of a hill if you want to. You can create little berms. And you can see that water runs downhill. And comes down here to this sort of flat spot, and you've got this little berm right here. So this is a terrace, and this is a little berm, and naturally water will just sink down here, and what you end up with is an underground well, so to speak, this oval-shaped well underneath this berm. So all of these plants that you plant in here will be able to reach down and grab that water. We had two droughts in the first 2 years that we did this, and I happen to live on top of a hill so I can see all my neighbors, and all of their gardens were brown and dying after 6 weeks with no rain, and ours was still green and lush, doing well. There's an example of how we set up the terraces. You can see here's the little downhill slope, there's the flat part, and there's a little berm right there. We kept the rocks in place. Those rocks are invaluable because what happens during the day is they heat up and they absorb heat, and at night they give that heat off. So actually it gives you a longer growing season. You can plant your more sensitive plants around those rocks. And they're not as susceptible to frost in the spring and frost in the winter, frost in the late fall. So there's the terraces after planting. I get a chance to do this again. There's the peach tree, that's catnip, that's oregano, that's parsley, I think, and there's thyme down there, and there's rosemary, etc. Benefits, provides all the fruit, veggies, nuts, and berries that you and your family can consume. We've got blackberries in left corner, figs in the center. Peanuts are another great nitrogen fixer. They will add nitrogen back to the soil. They're basically a legume like peas and beans. Honey, which we talked about. Those in the middle, that's Asian pears. And you can see they're not scabby, they're not wormy, and those are strawberries. Basically, these things come into season at different times, and that's great because I'm harvesting different stuff throughout the summer. Strawberries come first, then blueberries, blackberries, and eventually the last thing we end up harvesting is figs and passion fruit, which is a good thing because I'm bringing in three-gallon buckets a day. So 6 gallons of fruit every single day. And that's just going through and just picking stuff in an hour. And we have annual vegetables as well. We intermingle those with the perennials. And how it looks today. So those are blueberries right there. I put these kind of cages around them, and then I use this nylon deer fence, deer netting that I put on top of it. That allows the pollinators to get in, but doesn't allow the bees to take them. And I have a particular affinity for blueberries, and they're really great for medicinal purposes and such. So I want to get them before the birds do. So, I've got those netted right there. And this is just blackberries. So all of those white flowers will be blackberries right there. These are elderberries. These are just the flower parts. Elderberry is a great plant to have in a survival garden. The little teeny tiny berries are antiviral. So if you've got a cold and you take an elderberry syrup, it'll kill that cold. It works better than Tamiflu or anything else that's on the market. There is a product that's sold in CVS, the traditional pharmacies, called Sambucol. 4 ounces of that stuff is $14 a bottle. So this is a great thing to have in a survival garden because if you ever get a cold, you can use this stuff and make a tincture from it, and it'll cure a virus that you have. And those are the elderberries when they are ripe. So all those little flowers end up having berries on them, and you just go and pick those berries. That's a carrot, believe it or not. That's the stalk of the carrot. It's just starting to develop a seed head right there. That carrot is 5 feet tall. Hard to believe. Again, no fertilizer, no pesticide, and really very little work. So this is when we first planted it. and that's how it is today.